Okay, good morning everyone. In the series of lecture by our post-MD palliative medicine students, now today we have another lecture by Dr. Rutula. And I know very well this, that no one can introduce a person better than a teacher. So I will again request Dr. Joyita to introduce her as she did her MD palliative medicine from Tata Memorial Hospital. So Dr. Joyita, kindly introduce, and then please keep your question answer in the chat box. Arun will keep all the track of all the question answer and we will discuss at the end. So Dr. Joyita, please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Sushma ma'am. Always an honor and privilege to be part of this IPC online lecture series. So it is my privilege to introduce Dr. Rutula Sonawane. She did her MD palliative medicine from Tata Memorial Hospital, having completed it last year. She did her 1 year of SRship with us. Now she's assistant professor in palliative medicine in Bharti Vidyapeeth, Pune. She has a special interest in pediatric palliative care and also in non-oncology. And that is what she is doing, setting up service and taking care of oncology, non-oncology and pediatric palliative care in her workplace now in Bharti Vidyapeeth. She is also interested in research, and when she attended Credo in 2020, her protocol was selected as one of the best protocols from her group, which was on cognitive behavior therapy plus routine counseling versus routine counseling in addressing body image disturbance in advanced head neck cancer patients. And she has done a number of projects since then, and she has published a case report. So she again is one of the students that I am going to say that I am her teacher and not that she is my student. She is extremely talented with a great clinical acumen, a lot of empathy, and this has been evident in her work when she has been working with us, and I'm sure she's doing the same in where she is working currently. So over to you, Dr. Rutula. We are looking forward to your talk.
Thank you, ma'am, for a very lovely introduction. Good morning, everyone. I'll just start sharing my screen and then we'll start. Can everyone see my screen?
Yes, we can see. Slideshow kar do, Rutula.
Yes, ma'am. I'm just doing that. So good morning, everyone. Today we'll be discussing the topic of pediatric neurological conditions which need palliative care. So we'll be covering the topic in the following headings. As give a short brief introduction to the topic, then to classify what kind of disorders there are, and we will touch upon individual disorders which are very common in our scenario and the common symptoms that are associated with them, and as well as briefly touch upon the management. So while I was doing the research for this seminar, the thing that I realized was that pediatric neurology is a vast subject which will be very difficult to compress it into 1 hour of teaching session. So I've tried to cover as much as possible, but there might be some deficiencies along the way. So to start with, it is a disorder. The pediatric neurological disorders are huge in number in India, with a prevalence of around 1 to 3% in children less than 5 years of age. Most of them include epilepsy, CNS infection, developmental disorders, which are around 80%, and many of them have some preventable causes. For example, birth asphyxia, which is the highest risk factor in cerebral palsy, which accounts for more than 50% of the cases. So because it has a variable disease course, there is an unsteady decline and premature demise. because of this, there is a high caregiver burden and high family burden, and there is frequent need to revise the goals of care and end of life discussions, which can be challenging because there is waxing and waning along the way and cannot be that easily addressed. So we as palliative care can, you know, address this more easily and better give better end of life care, and goals of care can be more defined. So what are the barriers for applying palliative care in pediatric neurology? So first, as I mentioned before, there is a significant variability in the disease trajectory, particularly when it is pertinent to neurodegenerative metabolic disorders. So to pinpoint when the correct time to involve palliative care physicians is a big mystery and sometimes might be missed. Also, there is no formal structure, hospital structure or public structure in supporting integration of palliative care into pediatric neurology. And finally, sometimes it might so happen that the parents and the family themselves do not wish to go for palliative care because they feel that it means end of life and that the child won't survive much longer. So to classify neurological disorders, broadly they can be classified into developmental or congenital and acquired. So in congenital or developmental, there can be some developmental delays, which might or might not be associated with congenital malformations. Cerebral palsy comes in developmental as well as acquired, because if asphyxia is causing cerebral palsy, then it comes in both. In acquired, there are CNS infections, cerebral palsy, autism, myopathies, and epilepsy. So to touch upon the basic, I also want to mention that in CNS infections, though I have not covered that in detail in the following slides, the most important one will be tubercular meningitis, which is still very common, and though treatable, it has a high risk at the beginning of the treatment, as the symptoms might flare up because of increased intracranial tension and because of other associated symptoms. So during the intensive phase, it might be more our need might be more when as compared to along the treatment when the patient stabilizes. The other infections that are seen but are decreasing will be cerebral malaria and neurocystic sarcosis. Neurocystic sarcosis is also a leading cause of epilepsy. These are the infections I just wanted to touch upon. So the common disorders, first would be the most commonest would be cerebral palsy. So cerebral palsy is a descriptive term. It is not a diagnosis. The incidence is one or two in 1,000 patients. So what are the common causes of cerebral palsy? So basically, it can be prenatal, that is, as I said before, it can be congenital, so with congenital malformations of brain, or it can be perinatal, like as in perinatal hypoxia or birth trauma. There can be acid-base imbalance, there can be indirect hyperbilirubinemia or metabolic disturbances. Also in intrauterine growth restrictions or infections or low birth weight babies. So basically, these are the causes. Broadly, it can be typed into spastic cerebral palsy, in which spasticity is the most important clinical feature. And they are henceforth further classified into either hemiplegic, quadriplegic, diaplegic, or monoplegic. Then in dyskinetic, this is chorioathetoid or dystonic in nature. And usually will be caused by an hypoxic ischemic injury. Mixed will be both, there is some degree of spasticity as well as dystonia or chorioarthritoid movements here. There can also be cerebral signs depending on which site or where the site is and how much is the severity of the lesion. Ataxic cerebral palsy, it is generally spastic dystonic mixed type, which is the commonest. And so here mainly the signs will be of cerebellar involvement, that is poor balance, coordination or hypotonia. There can be wide-based gait or nystagmus. So what are the warning signs that the child might have cerebral palsy? So it can be the persistence of neonatal reflexes, that is, for example, Moro's reflex, beyond the age where they disappear. There can be persistence clonus, or there can be extreme irritability in the child. There is failure to show sensory motor signs, that, for example, smiling at the age of 3 months, poor head control at the age of 3 months, then inability to sit up at the age of 8 months, or unilateral hand use, or at 18 years of age, or there can be abnormal or asymmetrical crawling. Posturing can be abnormal, and there is difficulty in swallowing as well as chewing or while feeding in general. So this is a general classification, that is the gross motor functional classification, which is used to delineate individuals into 5 groups based on how much mobility they have. So first level is when the child is freely mobile and is able to carry out his day-to-day activities without any support. In level 2, he needs some sort of support for upward climbing. In third, he might need crutches or support or a wheelchair, but he can operate the wheelchair on his own. In level 4, as you can see, you need wheeled support, and even the wheelchair has to be electronic. In level 5, there is no head holding, so he might need head support and might require someone else to operate the wheelchair. So in general, the management can be divided into this. So it can be either reversible symptoms or irreversible symptoms. Symptoms, as I said, would be mostly either spasticity, dystonia, or a cerebral sign. So for spasticity mainly, this is the treatment plan. So if either oral therapy, so oral therapy would be muscle relaxants, or it can be intrathecal baclofen injections, botulinum toxin injections to relieve the spasticity, or surgery as in rhizotomy or fasciectomy can be done. There also is a role of deep brain stimulation and selective dorsal rhizotomy. So for the drugs, baclofen is the commonest drug for hypertonia. The usual starting dose is 5 mg thrice a day, at the dose starting from 0.3 mg per kg per day to up to a highest level of 5 mg per kg per day. Tizanidine is another drug which is frequently being used. Side effects include sedation and hypotension. So it is started at the low dose of 1 mg twice daily for less than 10 years of age, and 2 mg OD for more than 10. So the starting dose would be 0.05 mg per kg per day, 2 to 3 times in a day for more than 12 years. Diazepam, it is extremely effective, especially for short-term use and if you need an emergency muscle relaxant. As we all know, it's highly sedative and tolerance can easily be developed. So So the starting dose is 0.25 mg per kg twice daily. Maximum of 2.5 mg twice daily, or 5 mg for more than 12 years of age. So for myopathies, so basically these are a group of disorders which present as a weakness in the motor activity or strength. So, but it is important to differentiate between myopathies and neuropathies. So basically myopathies would follow a proximal distribution of weakness and muscle proximal distribution, whereas weakness and muscle wasting neuropathies are often distal in distribution. The deep tendon reflexes are present if very thoroughly diminished, but they are usually absent in neuropathies. The sensory abnormalities and fasciculations would be seen in neuropathies. So this is how you differentiate between the two. And so they are further classified into muscular dystrophies, which are the more common one than the congenital myopathies. The muscular dystrophies include your Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, Emery-Dreifuss type of muscular dystrophy, limb girdle, that is pelvic and shoulder dystrophies, facioscapulohumeral peroneal involvement, then there is distal muscle distal myopathy, and oculopharyngeal myopathy. The congenital myopathies are further divided into myopathies with protein accumulation, myopathies with core diseases, myopathies with central nuclear involvement, that is myotubular myopathy or centronuclear myopathy, and myopathies with fiber size variation. Then other myopathies are metabolic myopathies and inflammatory myopathies and Chaloner myopathies. So as I said before, muscular dystrophies are divided into Duchenne's, Emery-Dreifuss, limb girdle, facioscapulohumeral peroneal, distal and oculopharyngeal. So what are the signs and symptoms that you usually see? So we'll be discussing more on Duchenne's muscular dystrophy. So what are the signs and symptoms that you see? Basically during birth and just immediately after birth, there will be no signs of any dystrophy as such. They up to the age when they start to walk, everything is normal. So there are three major time points that we should watch for. So first is when they begin to walk, the second is when they lose the ability to ambulate, and the third is when they die. So basically they do not start walking up to the age of around 18 months. Then by the time they reach 5 years of age, the disease is manifested in all the muscle groups. So they have difficulties in carrying out their daily activity as well. For example, going to school, climbing up the bus or the stairs, or playing around. They are all hampered. So early features are generally gait abnormalities, which is classically waddling wide-based gait with hyperlordosis of the lumbar spine and toe walking. Grover's sign is a classic physical examination in muscular dystrophies because of the proximal muscle weakness. The child, while getting up from sitting or supine position, they use the elbow to knee position is present. So in Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, there are certain investigations that can help with the diagnosis. So these are generally serum creatine kinase, which in Duchenne's is around, the level would be around 5,000 to 35,000. Whereas the normal level is around 160 international unit per liter. Then aldolase and aspartate aminotransferase are also increased, but these are not that specific. then you need to do an ECG or ECG to rule out if there is any cardiac muscle involvement. You also need to do the electromyography to show myopathic features, but they are not specific to Duchenne's. And PCR can be done to check for the gene mutation. So in general, the treatment here is supportive, where you, like for example, when there is cardiac decompensation, you start the patient on, they usually respond well to digoxin. So the patient is started on digoxin. The pulmonary infection should be treated appropriately and promptly. And they should be wary of, they should take regular precautions to avoid getting such infections. Immunization should be up to date and regular. Nutrition should be maintained well, and physiotherapy to for the muscles to maintain the nutrition and functioning. The in definitive treatment, sometimes steroids can be given. These do not halt the progression of the disease, they just maybe slow down the progression. So prednisolone usually or deflazacort is used, so at the dose of 0.75 mg per kg for 10 days a month. So that's the schedule. Other drugs such as immunosuppressive drugs can also be used, but gene therapy is under evaluation. It is also important here that we ask the patient to go for genetic counseling. As it is, the mother is generally the carrier, and so we need to get the genetic testing done to avoid the disease in the other siblings, or to diagnose or to prevent or rather early detect the disease in the other siblings. So we come to the next topic of epilepsy. So epilepsy is another very common neurological problem in our country. The incidence is around 5 children per 1,000 patients. It is approximately 70% of all the neurological problems, and more than 50% of them start in the early childhood. And as epilepsy is very dangerous or deleterious, has a deleterious effect on the developing brain, it should be diagnosed and treated as early as possible to prevent further issues that arise with it. So it is classified as partial generalized or unidentified. That is the broad classification. Partial will be simple partial or complex partial. Generalized will be generalized tonic clonic seizure, generalized tonic, generalized clonic, and unidentified is which cannot be categorized in either of the two. A partial also includes the seizures which are start off as a partial seizure but proceed to become a generalized seizure. So these are the drugs that are generally used. Levetiracetamine is the first line for generalized epilepsy and partial epilepsy. The others are lamotrigine, oxcarbazepine, topiramate, vigabatrin, zonisamide, rufinamide, gabapentin, and tiagabin. So these are the starting and maintenance doses for each of the drugs. Levetiracetamine is generally started at the dose of 10 mg per kg per day, and the maintenance would be around 20 to 60 mg per kg per day. So for management in, so this is the flow diagram to just acutely manage the epileptic episode. So basically, once the seizure activity starts, you need to position the patient well and secure the airways, usually in the lateral decubitus. you should protect the child from injury. If required, 100% oxygen can be given or the may need intubation. Circulation and blood pressure ECG monitoring should be done. ABCs of resuscitation should be followed. IV line should be secured. During the same time, laboratory investigations are to be sent, because the most common causes of epilepsy in acute epilepsy in kids is generally either hypoglycemia or electrolyte disbalances or infection or other causes. So if it is hypoglycemia, then dextrose should be started at the dose of 1 to 2 ml per kg, that is 50% dextrose. So if it is not hypoglycemia, but it's still seizing, the patient should be given either benzodiazepines like diazepam, lorazepam to acutely manage the symptoms. If IV line is not accessible, then intrarectal diazepam or valproate can also be given. So preferred drugs should are either midazolam or lorazepam. But despite this, if the seizure persists, then phenytoin should be started. The loading dose is 20 mg per kg IV and in NS at the rate of 1 mg per kg per minute, and up to 30 mg per kg is given. If it is not getting controlled with that, phenobarb or valproate can be added, or levetiracetam, as I said, that is nowadays generally the first line of drug. If again with this, then diazepam drip should be started, or midazolam drip should be started to control the seizure. If that also fails, then the patient can be put into phenobarb coma, propofol infusion, lidocaine infusion, or valproate retention enema can be given. Along with this, the treatment for the underlying cause should be started and continued. And also, we should give the maintenance. Once it is controlled, maintenance drug should be started, and the patient should be on regular follow-up. The parent should be advised not to miss the dose if possible, and to regularly give the medicine and keep a good follow-up. So this is the management for the in neonatal period. So again, it's basically start with phenobarb or phenytoin, and then if it continues, then you repeat the phenytoin, add midazolam if necessary. Meanwhile, do the CSF study, CT, MRI, EEG, and metabolic workup, or a torch screening if indicated. And pyridoxine or exchange transfusion can be added or given if necessary. So this is autism is another spectrum which is neurodevelopmental in nature, with basically follows with disturbances in inability to communicate well, or socially awkward, or there are some restrictions in range of interests. So they are of the following types. So basically, it is a classic autism or Asperger's syndrome, or Rett syndrome, or pervasive developmental disorder, which is not specified. So classic autism is a condition which presents in the early childhood and is marked by abnormalities in communication and social interactions. And they have some atypical range of interests which are not common in their peer group. Asperger syndrome, they are non-retarded but can be clumsy kids with there is no speech delay as such, but there is some deficient social ability, and also have a very narrow range of interest. Then Rett syndromes is generally in girls with acquired microcephaly. There is infantile regression, lack of hand use, and there is a stereotypic hand wriggling movements that are seen in these kids. Pervasive developmental disorder, not otherwise specified, is basically autistic behaviors that do not classically fall into the above three groups. This is a very broad classification. So the features, so features that are seen in autistic kids is generally, as I said before, there is impairment in communication. There can be, so it might be that in milder cases, it might just be that there is an inability to hold up the conversation. In severe cases, they might be not at all communicating with anyone. With social interactions, impairment with social interaction include avoiding eye gaze, eye contact, or there can fear of crowded areas. Restricted range of interest includes where they are very focused on one activity in particular and generally do not like to be disturbed while doing that activity. It might range from coloring or video games or playing in the garden, etc. So again, here it is very important to early diagnose the syndrome, because then early rehabilitation can be started and early management of all the symptoms can be started, and to kind of neuro rehabilitate the child to better cope up socially and to communicate better with parents or colleagues or peer groups. So the early signs would be there are very subtle differences that sometimes might be missed. For example, there can be decreased vocalization. The child is somewhat very passive and does not respond much. There can be motor delays with low muscle tone. It might so happen that the child has no obvious social concerns. Like I said, eye contact is not there. Or reciprocity absent. There is proto-declarative pointing, that is, you use the index finger to indicate item of interest to another person. There is absence of this. So generally, a child does that when he indicates, like he points a finger to something which he's interested in. So if this is absent, that is predictive of autism. So generally, the family is generally interviewed to see for autism. So at the end of 12 months or 1 year, there generally in autistic kids, there is poor visual tracking. They are very quiet, lack social babbling. There is decreased social behaviors, that is smiling or response to game of peekaboo, etc. They lack basic imitation skills. There is extreme reactivity that they get very scared very easily and generally do not like an unknown stranger. There is atypical sensory oriented behaviors. They can have symptoms of ADHD, that is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. There can be high anxiety and mood symptoms. They can throw tantrums at about any particular moment. And 1/3 of the children also develop epilepsy or seizure disorders in early childhood and in adolescence. So again, here it is the, if you go for management, it becomes multidisciplinary. And the multidisciplinary team includes a psychologist, a communication disorder specialist to help them with their speech and ways to communicate. Physician, of course, because if possible, it is better to avoid any sort of ailment, other ailment in this child. Then they need to have a special educator who are trained in handling autistic kids. And the education pattern differs and is tailor-made to the particular. There is also an occupational therapist which help them for better mobility or overall daily activities. Then basic thing that we need to realize is that they need to have like a combined developmental, educational, and behavioral approaches, because all these aspects of their development are somewhat lacking. So usually these are homeschooled, and because crowd is very scary for them, so usually homeschooled, and the parents are at a high risk of burnout because they are with the child continuously. Sometimes it might so happen that one of the parents have to leave their job for for taking care of the child. There is an organization in India which works with children and adults with autistic spectrum disorders. They have quite a few useful information if needed. So that's about it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rutula. Are there any questions, Arun?
Thank you. No questions. But there is time. So if anyone has questions, can be posted in the chat box.
So maybe Dr. Joyita can answer this. That Dr. Joyita, with any children with any kind of a this kind of disorders, we should start counseling to the parents, because this is most difficult for parents to cope up. And last when Rutula has said that burnout in parents, so how should we address, because we have time, step wise address, how should we address the burnout in parents?
And so I think pediatric neurological disorders, and especially with autism, we need to have a multidisciplinary team, obviously, right at the beginning. And then Rutula has talked about the acceptability or, transition or integration with palliative care. So at some point, I think stepwise, once that original sort of parent multidisciplinary team is established, after that, gradually, I think the palliative care physician needs to be incorporated in that, because a lot of it is not just medical. There's so many psychological, and I think the most important is rehab for that. And a lot of the parental burnout comes from these other things apart from the medical. So the bit of logistic and practical support and having a support group, I think, helps a lot.
If I may add, so it's also like minute things. That recently I was speaking with a pediatrician. She mentioned that small things like just providing the parents with a wheelchair to mobilize the child easily help them cut down their burnout to a significant level. So I think we as palliative medicine physicians can provide all these minute details which the pediatricians might miss out because they are so overburdened and overworked. So that goes a long way in helping the child. And just listening to the parents about what goes on in their life daily, that also kind of helps them cope up with the situation better.
This is absolutely right, I think, Rutula, that listening to them and just small just sorting out small issues, I think that is more than enough for them. So what I realized that with a great difficulty we have learned, I think with a great difficulty I can say, we have learned counseling of parents, those who are suffering with cancer. But I have experience of one or two parents with neurodegenerative disorders of children and counseling them. And what I have realized that they understand everything. They know that what is the consequences of disease and how they will manage the routine, and they make it a routine for them. Only issue comes that they don't want that their child should suffer. So it is important that we should predict that what are the symptoms or what are the problems they can anticipate, and we should try to find out the solution beforehand. This is what I realized in two or three patients of neurodegenerative disorders parents. I realized, because you know, a neurologist is doing their job, they are giving them medication regularly, they know how to manage, and they know how to manage their routine activities, they practice it, they make it a habit that who will look after, one person will be there always or something like this. But as soon as this acute symptoms comes, they really become, I think they are already nervous, or they are already came to the terms of that their child is going to be like this and they have to manage it. But if there are any acute symptoms, they really get distressed. So it is important that we should anticipate the symptoms, and we should try to give the advice accordingly. So I can see one comment of respite care, Arun. Pradnya, Dr. Pradnya, do you want to speak? Hello?
Yes, madam.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, we from Tata Hospital, we have developed two centers at Kalwa, that is in Thane district, and with Nair Hospital. And in Kalwa, children, they come with the caregivers, and they play. There is a play facility for the children, and they spend their time there for 1 hour or 2 hours. And in that time, the caregivers they talk to the counselors, and they can they share their things and along with other caregivers, they share their there is lot of support to the caregivers that time. But the separate what we had thought initially was the daycare centers for children, so that the children can be children can spend some time, and at the same time the caregivers can do their work and then come to the place and take the children. But that we haven't yet started there.
This is absolutely true that parents are coming, seeing other parents also struggling the same thing, how they are managing. I think this makes really a huge difference. And also they are getting breaks for the routine for 1 or 2 hours. That is more than enough. So anything else, Arun?
So ma'am, I would like to add that since these child are undergoing a very long treatment trajectory, most of the time what happens is that even with minute illnesses, like for example, respiratory infections or gastro infections, they generally land up in the ICUs because of so many other comorbidities that they have. So I have seen many patients in my current institute, they are in the ICU, and the main challenge that the parents face is that we've done so much till now. I don't think we want to stop the further management just because there is a chance that they might not survive. So this becomes a big issue as to how to limit the aggressiveness of the treatment when you know that the treatment is futile, and how to withdraw or withhold further management from them, because parents are adamant as to not stop or not give the treatment to their kids.
So I think Rutula, parents are parents. They are not going to give
up. No, ma'am. But so basically, that's what I was saying, that early integration would go a long way to not do situations like this.
Excellent. Dr. Stanley, you want to give some comments on this, please? Dr. Stanley?
Yeah, thank you, Sushma. And thank you, Rutula, for that useful summary. I think one other aspect where, because this is a long, prolonged kind of situation, community involvement is the very important thing. You know, when the community gets involved, a lot of help is generated, and that way, you know, the parents are supported. And so I would just add that. Thank you.
Yes, absolutely right. That community, neighborhood, if they will help, I think this will make a huge difference.
Yeah.
So, Arun, I can't see any questions.
People don't. There's comments. Then. Yeah, Sima Mishra also said wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
So, thank you, Rutula. Thank you, Arun. Thank you, Dr. Joyita. And thank you, Nisha and Archana. We will come back again next Monday, 6:30. And please log in before 6:30 with your with whatever device you are using. Please name the device. Thank you very much, and have a good week.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great week, everyone.
Thank you.